Shenzhen, China. Chinese tech giant Huawei filed a motion in U.S. court Wednesday challenging the constitutionality of a law that limits its sales of telecom equipment, the latest action in an ongoing clash with the U.S. government. Huawei's chief legal officer, Song Liuping, said at a press briefing that Huawei had filed a motion for summary judgment asking the court to rule on whether it is constitutional for the U.S. to implement a military spending provision that bars the government and its contractors from using Huawei equipment. Huawei is the biggest global maker of network equipment, but it is now fighting to maintain access to major markets for next-generation communications as the U.S. claims the company threatens international cybersecurity. In March, Huawei launched its suit against the section of the U.S. National Defense Law in Plano, Texas, the headquarters of its U.S. operations. The complaint calls the U.S. provision a bill of attainder, which selectively punishes Huawei and violates due process by presuming Huawei's guilt without a fair trial. The summary judgment motion seeks to accelerate the legal process to give U.S. customers access to Huawei equipment sooner, according to a Wednesday statement from Huawei. Song said the state-sanctioned campaign against the company will not improve cybersecurity. Related slideshow, a timeline of U.S.-China trade war, provided by photo services. Two of the biggest economies in the world, the U.S. and China, are caught in the throes of a bitter and potentially catastrophic, for themselves and the world, trade war. Take a look at this timeline to understand the progression of the dispute between Washington, D.C. and Beijing. One of U.S. President Donald Trump's biggest campaign promises was to bring manufacturing jobs back to the country. In April, after becoming president, Trump directed the Commerce Department to determine whether the scale of import of steel from China and other countries posed a threat to national security. When announcing the investigation, Trump said, "For decades, America has lost all our jobs and our factories to unfair foreign trade. And one steel mill after another has been shut down, abandoned, and closed. And we're going to reverse that." A few months later, Trump expanded the scope of investigation, calling on U.S. Trade Representative Robert Lighthizer, L., to decide on a probe of unfair Chinese trade practices. In general, the executive order focused on alleged theft of American intellectual property through spying and hacking. In response, the Chinese Commerce Ministry said any actions of trade protectionism from the U.S. side would be harmful to the bilateral trade and business relationship in the interests of companies on both sides. In a sign of deteriorating relations between the two countries, China's Ministry of Foreign Affairs hit out at Trump for launching the investigations and trying to use them to pressure Chinese President Xi Jinping into supporting the U.S. in its efforts to control North Korea. The state-run China Daily newspaper wrote, "His idea of exploiting trade as a bargaining chip in dealings with China dates back to the campaign trail. But instead of advancing the United States' interests, politicizing trade will only exacerbate the country's economic woes and poison the overall China-U.S. relationship." Undeterred by Beijing's warnings, the Trump administration initiated its first major trade action against China, a 30% tax on imported solar panels. The majority of these come from China. In addition, a 20% tax was levied on large residential washing machines. In his statement, Lighthizer, pictured, said, "The president's action makes clear again that the Trump administration will always defend American workers, farmers, ranchers, and businesses." In this regard, on January 23, China's Commerce Ministry issued a statement condemning the U.S. move to tax solar panels. Part of the statement said, "China hopes the U.S. will exercise restraint in using trade restrictions." Beijing also aided it would resolutely defend its legitimate interests. The Trump administration's move to tax the import of washing machines upset South Korea as well. Seoul's trade minister, Kim Yun-chong, said the move was an excessive and a clear violation of World Trade Organization, WTO, rules. On March 9, Trump imposed a 25% tariff on steel imports and a 10% tariff on aluminum. The tariffs would impact every country exporting either material to the U.S., with the exception of Canada and Mexico. Trump said, America will remain open to modifying or removing the tariffs for individual nations as long as we can agree on a way to ensure that their products no longer threaten our security. China responded by calling the tariffs a serious attack on normal international trade order and said it is firmly opposed to the move. On April 2, Beijing announced tariffs on nearly $1 billion of U.S. imports. These tariffs included a 15% duty on products like fruits, wine, nuts and steel pipes. In addition, China also levied a 25% tax on goods like pork and recycled aluminum. The latter move alarmed the U.S. National Pork Producers Council, who claimed the $0.1 billion in exports to the Asian giant would be negatively impacted. China's Ministry of Commerce said it hoped the U.S. would withdraw its tariffs as soon as possible so that the trading of products between China and the United States will return to a normal track. The two countries continued to trade blows, with the U.S. adding 1,300 more items to the list of taxed goods. The products taxed included those from the aerospace and medical industries, both of whom were the subject of Trump's 2017 investigation into China's unfair trade practices. The sum total of Chinese exports to be taxed was $0 billion. The decision was criticized by the U.S. Chamber of Commerce, whose executive vice president, Myron Brilliant, said that although the move to restore balance in trade was correct, imposing taxes on products used daily by American consumers is not the way to achieve those ends. China then announced plans to impose a 25% tariff on U.S. exports worth $0 billion. The list of products to be affected included soybeans, chemicals, aircraft and automobiles. At the time, there was confusion over the date on which these tariffs would come into effect. In response, China's vice finance minister, Zhu Guangyao, said the intervening period could be used as a time to negotiate and compromise. An apparently frustrated Trump then threatened a further and steeper range of tariffs. On April 6, he said, in light of China's unfair retaliation, I have instructed the United States Trade Representative to consider whether $0 billion of additional tariffs would be appropriate. China's response, via Commerce Ministry spokesperson Gao Feng, pictured, was to say, we're prepared and have already formulated very detailed countermeasures. Trump's announcement was criticized by members of the Republican Party, with Nebraska Senator Ben Sasse calling it the dumbest possible way to do this. Washington, D.C.'s next move was against Chinese telecom giant ZTE. The firm was banned from purchasing components from U.S. companies. The U.S. Commerce Department claimed ZTE lied about punishing employees who violated sanctions against North Korea and Iran and slapped a 7-year ban on the company. Meanwhile, the UK government made a similar move, warning its companies from using the Chinese one's equipment and services. The following day, China's Commerce Ministry announced a staggering 179% fee on sorghum imports from the US. The grain is used in animal feed but is also popular in the country for making a local liquor. China imported over 60 million of sorghum in 2017, according to data from CNN. In the first sign of a potential thaw in relations, on April 21, U.S. Treasury Secretary Steven Mnuchin, pictured, said a trip to China was possible and that he was cautiously optimistic a trade deal could be agreed between the two countries. In response, on April 22, China's Commerce Ministry said, China has received a message from the U.S. about its willingness to hold bilateral trade talks in Beijing. China welcomes this move. Talks between senior U.S. and Chinese officials began in May, in Beijing. They were described by the White House as frank discussions. The Chinese were more circumspect, with official news agency Xinhua saying, both sides realize there are some relatively big differences on some issues. and more work needs to be done to achieve more progress. On May 13, Trump tweeted, "President Xi of China and I are working together to give massive Chinese phone company, ZTE, a way to get back into business, fast. Too many jobs in China lost. Commerce Department has been instructed to get it done." A spokesperson for China's foreign ministry responded, "We very much appreciate the positive statement from the U.S. side on ZTE and maintain close communication with them on the issue." On May 17, U.S. officials told CNN Beijing had proposed a boost in Chinese purchases of U.S. products by nearly $0.00 billion in order to address trade imbalances between the two nations. The following day, Liu Kang, pictured, responded, "These rumors are not true." At the same time, China also announced it was removing the 179% tax on the import of U.S. sorghum. 4 days later, Mnuchin told Fox News, "We're putting the trade war on hold. We have agreed to put the tariffs on hold while we try to execute the framework." The statement came after news. U.S. and China had agreed to not impose tariffs while talks were ongoing. In response, China then announced, with effect from July 1, a reduction in import duties on passenger cars from the U.S., from 25% to 15%. The decision was one of some promises made by Jinping to Trump and included a significant reduction of fees on imported auto parts as well. What followed was a surprising revival of tariff threats against Beijing. On May 29, the White House announced it would go ahead with an earlier plan to levy a 25% duty on $0 billion of Chinese goods containing industrially significant technology. In its statement, the U.S. government said, "The United States will request that China remove all of its many trade barriers, including non-monetary trade barriers, which make it both difficult and unfair to do business there." Beijing issued a strong response to the new threats, with Foreign Ministry spokesperson Hua Chunying saying, "We want to reiterate that we don't want a trade war, but we aren't afraid of fighting one. If the U.S. insists on acting arbitrarily and recklessly, China will take firm and powerful measures to safeguard its own legitimate rights." Beijing also decried what it saw as U.S. efforts to unsettle China ahead of talks with American Commerce Secretary Wilbur Ross, saying, "In international relations, an about-face are constant. Change of positions is bound to damage or squander a country's credibility." Ross met with Chinese Vice Premier Liu He in Beijing over the first week of June. At the end of that discussion, China said it would purchase U.S. products worth nearly $5 billion in 2018. The decision was seen as Beijing's attempt to reduce the deficit in trade balances between the two countries, something Trump repeatedly pointed out in his relationship with China. On June 7, the U.S. government said it had reached a deal with Chinese firm ZTE that would allow the telecom giant to return to trading with American partners. The deal included the payment of a record $0.4 billion in escrow, fine, and proposed management changes. The Trump administration's unpredictable handling of the trade issue took a new turn on July 6, with the U.S. slapping $4 billion of tariffs on products like farming plows and airplane parts. The government said a further $6 billion in tariffs could be imposed in 2 weeks or less. The move was criticized by Robert Holliman, a senior trade official who served under former President Barack Obama, who said, "Once these tariffs start going into effect, it's pretty clear. The conflict is real. If we don't find an exit ramp, this will accelerate like a snowball going down a hill." The latest salvo in a rapidly escalating trade war was fired by China, who imposed a similar $4 billion of tariffs on 545 American products. Liu Kang confirmed the development, saying, "After the U.S. activated its tariff measures against China, China's measures against the U.S. took effect immediately. The Trump administration retaliated by imposing a 10% tariff on an additional $0.00 billion of Chinese imports." Some of the products included in the list facing tariff were manufactured under the Made in China 2025 initiative, which is a strategic plan to help China dominate the major global industries. The Trump administration directed the Office of the United States Trade Representative, USTR, to consider a 25% tariff, more than double the one in July, on $0 billion worth of goods, including construction materials, textiles, tools, food and agricultural products. China also issued a second round of tariffs. On August 7, the USTR issued a final list of Chinese goods worth $6 billion that will be hit with tariffs. In response, China imposed a 25% tariff on $6 billion worth of U.S. imports, such as medical equipment, fuel, steel products and autos, both effective from August 23. Broadening the divide in an already escalating trade dispute, Trump threatened to impose tariffs on another $67 billion of goods. Speaking about the additional tariffs, Trump said, "The $0 billion we are talking about could take place very soon depending on what happens with them. To a certain extent, it's going to be up to China. And I hate to say this, but behind that, ice another $67 billion ready to go on short notice if I want. That totally changes the equation." In a what was then viewed as a positive move in Asian markets, the U.S. sought to reinitiate trade talks with China before the proposed increase of tariffs on $0 billion worth of Chinese goods. "There's some discussions and information that we received that the Chinese government, the top of the Chinese government, wished to pursue talks. And so, Secretary Mnuchin, who is team leader with China, has apparently issued an invitation," explained Larry Kudlow, pictured, director of the U.S. National Economic Council. On September 18, USTR released a list of approximately $0 billion worth of Chinese imports to be subject to an additional 10% starting September 24. The level would increase to 25% starting January 1, 2019. Though Trump warned, "We will immediately pursue Phase 3, which is tariffs on approximately $67 billion of additional imports, if China takes retaliatory actions." China hit back with plans to impose tariffs on U.S. goods worth $0 billion. Amid escalating tariff threats and trade tensions, China pulled out of proposed talks on September 22. 2 days later, the U.S. and China imposed another round of tariffs against each other's goods. China also published a white paper against the economic hegemony and trade bullyism practices of the U.S. administration. Senior trade officials of both sides met for a working-level contact that could possibly lead to a meeting between Trump and Xi on the sidelines of the G20 summit in Argentina. Bloomberg reported that if the planned meeting between the two world leaders does not yield any favorable result, then the U.S. will prepare to announce tariffs on remaining goods imports from China by early December. Weeks before Trump and Xi were due to meet at the G20 summit, U.S. Treasury Secretary Steven Mnuchin, pictured, and his Chinese counterpart Vice Premier Liu He spoke on phone and resumed discussion on ways to ease the trade tension. While the U.S. maintained that China make an offer before negotiations can start, China decided to wait for the discussion to begin before making a formal proposal. Diffusing tensions caused by months of trade threats, Trump and Xi met for a dinner meeting at the G20 summit on December 1 and agreed to halt new trade tariffs for a period of 90 days to facilitate talks. The first face-to-face meeting between the two leaders since the trade war erupted was described by Trump as an amazing and productive meeting with unlimited possibilities for both the United States and China. After the 90-day negotiation window was put in place, China temporarily lowered tariffs on cars and parts originating in the U.S. for 3 months. The country also resumed purchase of soybeans from the U.S., a practice it had stopped in July 2018. Between January 7 and January 9, the two met to reach a consensus. The U.S. noted China had agreed to purchase a substantial amount of agricultural, energy, manufactured goods, and other products and services from the United States. In a separate statement, China said both sides held broad, deep and meticulous discussions on shared observations on trade issues and structural problems, laying the foundation for addressing areas of common concern. A second round of talks was held January 30-31. In an interview with the New York Times after the talks, Trump said, "Without the tariffs, we wouldn't be talking. And I make this point clear to them." Pictured, Trump meets with China Vice Premier Liu He, second L, at the White House in Washington, D.C., on January 31, 2019. Ahead of the March 1 deadline of the 90-day trade truce, top officials engaged in several rounds of talks to reach a consensus on issues from currency manipulation to market access. Aside. By-side comparison by Bloomberg of the statements released by the two countries after their meeting in Beijing showed that while the U.S. made no mention of a consensus, China noted the sides reached consensus in principle on major issues, with a view toward a memorandum of understanding on bilateral economic and trade issues. Politicians in the U.S. are using the strength of an entire nation to come after a private company, he said. This is not normal. The U.S. and China are embroiled in a protracted trade dispute and tariff war that began last July following complaints from President Donald Trump that China steals from or pressures foreign companies to hand over technology while unfairly subsidizing Chinese businesses. The most recent round of negotiations earlier this month ended with no agreement after Trump tariff and double duties on $0 billion in Chinese imports. China responded by raising tariffs of 5% to 25% on $0 billion worth of American goods. Soon afterward, the U.S. Commerce Department placed Huawei on its entity list, effectively barring U.S. firms from selling its technology without government approval. Huawei relies heavily on U.S. components, including computer chips, and about one-third of its suppliers are American. The move has already affected the company's U.S. partnerships. Google said it would continue to support existing Huawei smartphones, but future devices won't carry its flagship apps and services, including Maps, Gmail, and Search, a change that will likely make Huawei phones less appealing. Song said the U.S. is setting a dangerous precedent. Today it's telecoms and Huawei, he said. Tomorrow it could be your industry, your company, your consumers.